When building houses, every home gets a unique address. That address provides a direct reference to that home. Same when building a website. Every website has a unique address that provides a direct reference to that website. For web applications, that unique address is called a URL, or Uniform Resource Locator. It's called a Uniform Resource Locator, not a Uniform Web Page Locator, because a URL address can refer to a web page, an image, or any other web resource. We type the URL into a browser address bar here. Think of it like typing an address into Google Maps or your car's navigation system. A URL is primarily comprised of three parts. First is the scheme or protocol. It defines how the browser sends and receives information on the web. Think of it like picking the postal service, UPS, or FedEx when you send a package. The most common protocol for websites is HTTPS, though you may see HTTP. HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol, which is how resources are transferred or copied across the web. HTTPS is preferred because the S stands for secure. HTTPS protects information as it's transferred across the web. In most browsers, this part of the URL is set by default, so we don't have to type it in. Next is the domain name. It provides a unique identifier to the computer, called a web server, that contains the website. Think of the domain name as the website address. After the domain name is an optional path to a file on the web server. This is the file containing the web page, image, or other resource. If no file name is provided, by default, the web server looks for a file named index.html. In many cases, the path is not necessarily a physical path on the web server, but rather a logical name used to find the file or other resource on the web server. Think of the domain as the building's address, and the path as the location of a specific room within that building. You may see additional information added to the end of the URL. This is called a query string and is used to pass information or data to the web server. For example, if our website allows a user to create a custom virtual pet, we pass the user's entered data to the web server for storage. Or if we were searching for socks, our entered search text could be passed as a query string. The query string starts with a question mark, then the data, defined as name and value pairs, separated with ampersands. Each name and value pair has a name that describes the data, an equal sign, and the data value. For the first pair, the name is pet-name, and the value is Vanny. The second pair has a name of pet-type and a value of cat. We don't normally type in a query string, but if you watch the browser address bar as you navigate to other sites, such as Amazon, you'll often see the site add a query string. Let's try out some URLs. Feel free to try it yourself as we go through this demo. I've opened my browser, which is Chrome. We can type a URL directly into the address bar. But more commonly, we search using a search engine, such as Google or Bing. In the search box, I'll type socks. Notice the address bar. I'll zoom in. Most browsers now hide the protocol, but if I click twice in the address bar, it shows HTTPS, so it's secure. The lock icon here also indicates that we are using a secure protocol. The domain is www.google.com, and the path to the resource is search. The question mark defines the query string, so everything after it is data passed to the web server. Here is our search term. We are looking for socks. And hopefully the web server receiving this data knows what these other name and value pairs mean. I'll zoom back out. Here is the result from our search. We have numerous links to choose from. Search engines, such as Google's, look through public websites, read their content, and index the sites, similar to a book index or table of contents. When we type in something, the search engine looks through its index and presents a set of related links. If we want search engines to find the websites we create, we'll need to build our web pages so they are easy for a search engine to read and index. We can click a link to access any of the search results. To check a URL before clicking it, hover over it, and we see the URL associated with the link, really small here in the corner. Pre-checking links before clicking is often a good idea, especially when getting a link in an email or when viewing unsecure sites. But what happens when we click a link? Let's go back to the slides. Think of the web like an interconnected set of libraries, each containing many documents. My, those are some fancy libraries. Each of those libraries represents a web server at a data center somewhere. A web server is a computer that stores documents, which can be web pages and other resources, such as images and movies, and serves them out to the browser. Together, these interconnected web servers store everything we see on the web. On our phone, tablet, computer, or other internet-connected device, we use a browser to type in a URL or enter a search term and click a link. The browser sends a request for the linked resource using the specified protocol, such as HTTPS. The browser looks up where to find the web server using the domain name, in this case, the fictitious petcafe.com. The web server then locates the requested document on that server using the path, in this case, pets/pet-list.html. If no file is specified, it defaults to index.html. When the desired document is found, the web server responds to the browser's request by downloading a copy of the document to the browser. That's when the browser really gets to work. If the downloaded document is a web page, the browser parses the document, meaning it reads through the document and begins processing what it reads. If there are links to other resources, such as images in the document, the browser locates and downloads those as well. The browser then begins to lay out the web page, figuring out what content belongs where. Lastly, it displays the web page within the browser. And that's how the web works. So, a URL is comprised of a protocol, such as HTTPS, which defines how to transfer or copy the resource. A domain name, such as our fictitious www.petcafe.com, that provides the address to the web server containing the resource. An optional path identifying how to find the resource on that web server. And an optional query string to pass data to the web server. When you enter or click on a URL, the browser sends a request for a web resource, such as a document containing a web page. The web server receives the request and issues a response with the resource, that document. Think of this request and response like a customer and waiter. You request a latte, and the server responds with that requested latte. The browser then sips that latte. Oh, no, no. If the resource is a document containing a web page, the browser then reads the document and lays out and displays the page. But where does HTML fit into all of this? We'll answer that question next.